Hello,
everybody.
Oh, I see what you did there. You did like you matched my thing.
I was following your lead.
Should we try and do it? So it's hello, everybody, and welcome to the Elite Dangerous live stream. You ready? On 3, 2, 1.
Hello everybody, and welcome to the Elite Dangerous live stream.
I'm Edward Lewis. You're not Edward Lewis, though. So that, at that point, we have to stop and cut things separate, make things separate.
Yeah, we're live.
Hey. Hey, everyone. Tonight, I am joined by the wonderful, the incredible, the lab-coated Dav Stott. Dav?
Good evening.
What is your job title?
I am a lead server developer on Elite Dangerous.
Elite Dangerous. Round of applause, everybody, for Dav Stott in the chat. Please throw down your rounds of applause and also love as well, because Dav has taken a lot of his personal time out this weekend to look through your pages and pages of questions.
So many
Reddit
questions.
And forums. but tonight you're going to be answering quite a lot of questions. We've got graphs, we've got giraffes, we've got laughs,
and
we've got
other things ending in faffs.
Faffs, a load of faff. That's what we've got. But yeah, absolutely wonderful. Yes, good to see everybody.
Yes.
And thank you for coming along as well. We'll try and keep our eye on the chat as well. But just to let you know, there are 7 pages of notes here that Dav's made with questions from you guys. But I think that you'll enjoy some of the answers. I think that it's going to be a fun time. I'm going to listen very, very carefully and attentively, he says, loading up the video game Elite Dangerous to play while you talk.
I sense some delegation going on here.
That's not true. I just thought I would put this in the background to play, so we have something pretty to look at.
Yes. Nobody wants to look at me talking for an hour and a half.
Yeah, or my face for an hour and a half either. And that's it. We'll probably be roughly here for about an hour and a half, or it depends on how long these questions are going for.
Yes.
But do get comfortable. Get yourself a cup of tea or coffee, depends on your preference, or a cold drink if you like. Whatever makes you comfortable. Water.
Yep.
There are other liquids are available.
That is not gin.
Not gin, honest. But you know, a nice gin, as long as it's after midday.
After the watershed.
Yeah, as long as it's after midday, it's okay. But sit down. I think some of the stuff that Dav covers tonight should be a lot of fun. Again, what is it that you are going to go into detail tonight so people get an expectation of what we're talking about specifically
Absolutely.
Tonight?
So specifically tonight, it was quite a wide area.
Yes.
So we're talking a lot about factions, mm-hmm. A bit about conflicts, a little bit about trade. So that's kind of gameplay mechanics. But we're also going to talk a little bit about some of the technical behind the scenes things.
Ooh.
There was an awful lot of questions about networking and instancing, and a couple of questions about servers as well, which is kind of handy, as it's nice to talk about servers once in a while.
Mm-hmm. Well, very good.
But
so it is going to be very inside baseball, as it were. So
yeah.
This is going to be for the people who...
spreadsheets
know
are the ready.
Game well, yeah. Get your spreadsheets at the ready to take down this information. And we literally do have a moving infographic that you've created at one point, which is very exciting.
That's one word for it.
I wouldn't call it a video.
No,
I'd call it a moving, an animated.
We'll call it spreadsheet. We'll call it an illustration.
An animated illustration.
Yes, if we need it.
A graphic. What's GIF?
If a waffle is baked like a biscuit, do I count it as a biscuit?
No. Absolutely not. It is a waffle.
No, because it's made out of batter, not
yes,
dough.
Yes, that's correct. See, Dav knows these things. He's a man of science. You are also wearing a lab coat, of course.
Yes, lab coat
that is to show that you are officially a scientist.
It's pretensions, delusions of grandeur.
Yes.
And sometimes you feel like you need it just to get all the splashes, because somebody said that servers get blamed for a lot, and this has helped to... helps cover the mess.
I'm just wearing denims, like a...
It doesn't show the marks.
No, that's right. Also, you are wearing a Distant Worlds badge as
yes.
well, which you can see there.
Some amazing swag from last year.
All the swag that comes through, it's yes. lovely. All right, so let's... this is so weird for me. Dav, we have the same name.
Well, Aww. That has never happened before in my life, so hello, Mr. Gamble.
Oh, it's lovely.
Yes.
Well, finally, Dav's found his fellow Dav.
I need
a
new nickname.
A scientist. Okay, so how do we begin then? How you've
let's just launch straight in.
First of all, say yes. Well, thank you for spending all of the time this weekend looking through the forums. I know you have been doing, as well as your lunchtime today, and also for taking your time as well for coming here tonight after work hours as well, after you've had a full day at work as well doing server stuff. So thank you.
Let's hope it's worth it. plenty of interest.
I'll load the game up at least.
Yeah, absolutely.
Let's into a private group, of course.
Yeah.
Don't tell anyone.
Might make it a little bit safer, at least to start with. So, let's launch straight into it. Let's talk a little bit about factions.
Okay.
There's a lot of factions in the game, dozens of thousands of them. Many of them are over suggested by players. Many of them started off with the game. Many of them were seeded as part of some of the narrative that goes on in it. And many people ask questions about how the factions interact with each other, how the simulation works. And the first thing I'm going to prefix this with is the key word in background simulation is the word background. I know I'm quoting from my colleague Adam Bork-Waiter, who I'm afraid couldn't be here this evening. But in general terms, it's part of the game that means that the galaxy reacts to the player's actions, everybody's actions, in a relatively difficult to describe way, because there's an awful lot of actions, there's an awful lot of galaxy, and it's difficult to predict exactly what players do. But in general terms, if you do positive things to a faction, good things will happen to it. If you do negative things to it, bad things will happen to it. If you do a lot of them, you get big things happening. That is pretty much the design goal of the background simulation. Yes, behind the scenes, it's full of clouds of numbers and reams of data, but that's far too complicated to try and display inside the game client, which is why a lot of the questions for, can we have more data about this, show us the history of that, it's, yes, it is there, but it's too difficult to communicate in a way that's useful to the majority of players. So we're going to start with Commander Schlack.
Commander Schlack,
and we will probably come back to him again and again. And congratulations for being quite so comprehensive. So first of all, to answer his hopes from the middle of the background sim forum thread, which yes, I was reading at o'clock on Sunday night. I was doing my homework, Commander, as you hoped. So the first question was more like a comment of assets and liabilities. For example, lots of people murdering skimmers at a settlement. And the answer to that is yes. Yes, they are. Factions that are present in many systems and control many markets and are present in many places, they have a much wider surface area to have interactions with. It's both a boon, if you like, having big factions, and a curse, because you've got a big faction. It's kind of harder to control, just like any other large organisation that is maybe spread across dozens of light years and has many hundreds of thousands of population in it. So yes, having settlements is not always a good thing, but depends on what you're aiming for. If you like having lots of places with your faction's name next to it, then go for it.
I'm just trying to give you a little look, if you look, but it's too big, so it kind of looks like we're both lead developers.
Yeah, let's not have that.
Start. But just in case anyone asks, I can just go, if anyone says who's that, I can just go, bam!
Yeah, absolutely.
And then everyone will, so just trying to help.
So speeding up a little bit, because if I keep talking to that level of detail, we'll still be here on Wednesday.
No, it's good.
There was a question, again from Commander Schlack, is there an automatic background sim mechanism that can trigger famine or outbreak without a human commander intervention? For example, a hidden food supply bucket that empties over time. Again, yes. Yes, there is. Relatively recently, as in probably about, I don't know, half a year ago, three quarters of a year ago, we were reviewing the state of the galaxy. I can't believe you can say that sort of thing with this game.
It's reviewing the state of the galaxy.
It's a bad job.
Casually.
Just throw that out there. However, we saw that there were very few famine and outbreak states that were happening naturally. So behind the scenes, yes, there is a little bit of natural famine and outbreak that occurs. It's very, very minor when you look at just one particular faction and one particular star system, but it's quite significant when you aggregate it across the whole galaxy. But if players are interacting with it, it will be dwarfed. But if nobody interacts with it, yes, you'll get a bit of outbreak, yes, you'll get a little bit of famine. But it won't be a chronic problem for any of the player factions, because there's so many player interactions, it would dwarf all of the background effects. There was another question of, are player-managed factions treated differently by the background simulation? We have seen reports of inserted player-managed factions entering into the wrong kind of conflict for their government type. So there's two points in there. The first is that conflicts are not based on the government type. They're based on one of the hidden parameters, which is a question a bit later on. So when you say government type, I'm sorry, but that's not how conflict types are designed. And player factions are absolutely no different to any other faction in the galaxy. We just spend a lot more time answering questions about them. So, moving on. Yeah, that's an evil laugh.
We've got our.
Yes, okay. We've been captioned.
We've got our captions now.
You, that was very well behaved. You could could have gone worse.
Sorry.
Absolutely. So. Yeah. So Captain Kirby asks one of his questions now. Given there are multiple factions that are about to expand, how does the system figure out which faction expands first, and maybe goes into a target system of another faction, which then have to search for another target system.
Yep.
Yeah, absolutely.
Give me a concise answer to that one.
Yeah, there's a lot of that when you're dealing with the background simulation and debugging it. There's so many, oh, when this happens and this happens and this thing over here and the moon's in that phase, what happens? There's a lot of state involved. And along the same lines, many people asked, can you give us an indication of how the background sim chooses which system that a faction will expand from where more than one system is above the expansion threshold? So that's when one faction has a more than, it's either 60 or 70% influence, I forget the exact number, might even be 80% influence in one system, it becomes eligible for an expansion. If they're present in multiple systems, how does it choose? So to answer both questions at once, the background sim goes through each faction, or each active faction in turn, I should say, and then each star system in turn. First come, first served. The order is not specified, although it's relatively consistent, so please don't try and predict it. 75%, thank you, Elemental. So yes, there is an order, but it's not really a predictable or advertisable one. So the next question was, and I think this one was also from Captain Kirby, how are countdowns and cooldowns of states supposed to work? Especially, but not only, if other states are about to get triggered or are already ongoing. So this one is, we might need to review some of the information that Adam, Ed and I did on the live stream previously, earlier on last year, might have been January, February time, something like that. There is a queue system, and I won't go into too much detail, mostly because I haven't got enough notes with me. But when a faction is eligible for a state, it is popped into the queue and shows up in the game as pending. And for factions present in large numbers of systems, they'll generally have so many inputs to them that many different states will be eligible. Like you might be having a boom in one system and a lockdown in another, and they all kind of end up in a queue and backing up against each other. But some states are more important than others. So for example, if you're in an economic boom, that's pretty good for trading and pretty good for influence in that system, but not much use if you're trying to expand into another system, or if somebody's invaded you and you've got a conflict pending. So for that, we have a priority system. So a faction can be merrily in a boom, and it can be sitting there ticking down through its maximum duration of the boom state. But then a expansion might come along and say, I'm now ready to go live, I've finished counting down, I'm ready to expand. At that point, the background simulation will say, okay, an expansion state is a movement state. That's more important than an economic state. So the boom is going to end early, get out of the way, and the movement state is coming through. And the same holds true for conflict as well, which kind of has a certain amount of context involved. If you're a faction with a few million people in it and you're having economic boom times and then you're suddenly plunged into a war and you're fighting for your very survival, you're going to put the economic state to one side and pick up the guns.
I'm sorry, keep going. I'm enjoying myself.
Weren't you supposed to be playing with the game rather than playing with the caption machine?
I'm having a lot of fun with the caption machine.
It is a good toy to have.
Yeah, I'm very impressed.
Absolutely. So One downside to the queuing system is that you will often get economic states all queuing up at once, and there's not really a huge amount that you can do about that. So a boom might be ready to go, and a bust and a lockdown are all barging for attention.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
No, good. I just want to double check really quickly, because you're flying through this, which is fantastic. This is what we need to do, because you've got lots more to say.
But I am going really quickly.
No, it's really good. I just hope that already people find this useful. Do let us know in the chat if you are enjoying what Dav is saying. Please do. Please.
Do throw snowballs. Keep the feedback coming through. Or say, slow down, or... Well, I thought this was supposed to
be... Do you want a cup of tea, Dav? Oscar's just said, instead of looking at Dav, why don't you just get him a cup of tea? I'll see you later, guys.
Absolutely. Tea, Earl Grey, hot.
There you go.
To quote one of my colleagues.
See you.
No, make me smaller, please. Much smaller.
Sorry, yeah, we've got lots to cover. I don't want Scott to stop being...
I'm going to take that mouse off him in a minute.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Okay, keep so...
keep it coming, good info. You're
absolutely.
Taking notes. Yes, don't stop. Thumbs up.
Hopefully there will be a video on demand. Watches in slow motion.
Very good. Yeah, good.
No, so, anyway, moving right along.
Coming through, because it helps us.
So, part of the... problems with loads of states going on and there being history involved is that trying to make that available within the game for you all to see and understand is something of a never-ending exercise. And the biggest way of that being visible is through the local news stories. I mean, yes, obviously conflicts are a bit more visible, but by and large, the local news stories are the place to go and get information on the background sim. And yes, we hear you loud and clear that news reports could be a little bit more informative about exactly what's going on when conflicts end, whether an asset has changed hands, whether there was a winner or a loser or something like that. I'm making no promises here. I don't have a caveat, anything like as big enough as Sandy's.
Sandy knows Marco.
No, I'm not going to go near his caveat. So I'm not going to be promising anything tonight, but as Bernard might say, that's under active consideration.
Very nice.
Absolutely.
Reference.
So moving along. So.
Sorry, no, keep going. You can't. You've got to ignore that. You've got too much stuff to get through.
Absolutely. Well, the chat's half the fun. Anyway, So Commander Ramirez Curita, apologies for the pronunciation, asks about what hidden values do factions have and what they actually affect. So the first one is a faction's type. This is like a part of the characteristic of each faction that is... It's kind of on its way out. It's no longer directly displayed inside the game. The government is displayed now. But each faction behind the scenes can be criminal, authoritarian, social, or a corporation.
Oh.
And so every faction has one of those, and that's what's used to determine the conflict type. So
is that something that's public?
It used to be, but isn't anymore, because it didn't. The only thing it's really used for nowadays is for the conflict types. Criminals go to war with everybody. If you're the same type as somebody else and you're in the same system, you'll do an election. Huh. If you're invading somebody, as in not in your home star system, then it'll be a war, not a civil war. Mm. There's a few little rules, and that's pretty much the only place that's used now. However, there are also, and this is the most important thing, there's also an awful lot of buckets behind the scenes. These are proverbial buckets, they're actually big server databases. As players fly around the galaxy, interact with factions, maybe do loads of trading, sell some exploration data, do a bunch of missions, there's a whole bunch of buckets that get, say, plus 10 to boom, minus 5 to bust, plus 50,000 to lockdown, plus 15 to influence, plus 9,000 to influence. And those buckets fill up during the day, and Every time the background sim sweeps past, it empties the buckets, turns them into the game results, and then the whole cycle starts over again.
Spelling. Sorcerer.
Absolutely. What sort of sorcerer? Worcestershire sorcerer?
Worcestershire sorcerer. I can't. Don't ask me to spell Worcestershire. I can do it really.
That's probably for the best.
Can we try that?
Absolutely. So yes, there are a few hidden ones, but the biggest reason that we don't display them, first of all, they change too often. And secondly, it's very difficult to...
Is that right?
You see what we have to work with here.
These guys know more than even you do.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry.
I'm so glad I only do these three times a year. So the biggest reason we don't display the hidden numbers, first of all, they change too often, so that as soon as you read them, they'll be out of date. And the second thing is that it can be difficult to be given a number and then see a result in the game and correlate the two, because there are so very many different dependencies inside the system. So they're hidden for a reason, I'm afraid. So, moving right along, Commander Rubber Nuke asks, with a logo from a completely different franchise, HAL 9000, out of curiosity, how much data is generated by each tick of the galaxy each day? The daily log is about 1 GB when it's uncompressed, but that's just for the faction simulation. There are undetermined but very, very large amounts of data behind the scenes. Exploration data, for example, is easily the biggest data set we have. Everybody's mission status, that's pretty big. People's reputation, the factions. You imagine the number of commanders multiplied by the number of factions, that's quite a big number as well. So it's lucky we've got some big database servers that handle all this for us.
Large.
Yeah, large.
Very.
We may get as far as extremely large, but I'm not going to promise future events. Also, right. Why is there a daily tick in the first place? Is it because of the amount of data needed to be shifted? Yes, but also we need to try and keep things in sync, because as you might imagine, we have many people's game clients running at once and we have many servers all running at once. So we need to try and keep things in sync. And we also need to give players a reasonable chance of a level playing field. And one day was deemed to be the smallest design that we could probably get away with. In terms of striking a balance between a dynamic galaxy and having something that is understandable that people can then go and play against. There's no point having a conflict that only lasts 3/4 of an hour if you're flying across the galaxy and you try and get there just before it ends.
So can I just quickly point out, Stephen Davis says, Edward, your guest looks like a mad engineer from the game.
I'll take that.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Stephen Davis.
Great Scott. So finally, the final question from Commander Rubbernuke is, when the tick happens each day, which areas are updated first? In my area of space, the background sim is not updated fully until an hour after the official time. I really should have this on a cue card, but we do say this every time. There is no official time that the background sim runs every day. We simply say that it runs approximately once every 24 hours. If it runs a bit earlier or a bit later, that's fine. Yeah. No work will ever be lost. And yes, everything will scale depending on how long it was since it last ran. But don't try and predict the tick.
Don't try and predict the tick.
Absolutely. I'm talking to you, the Tracking the Tick forum thread. So I'm going to jump in here with a question from Steve Ross because it's timely. Daily ticks seem to reset market prices. Is this true? There is a market tick rate that runs on a different schedule to the faction tick rate. The market ticks generally runs every 5 to 10 minutes or so, and that's when the prices are updated. That evaluates when the how much stock of each commodity is available in each market, or how much demand is available in each market, how much commodity has been produced, and therefore how much. So if Commander's bought loads and loads of, I don't know, palladium for something, how much palladium is being produced, and therefore to restock it at a certain rate. Mm. And that runs much more quickly.
It's interesting to note that the tick zero in the chat says, here, here, don't try tracking me.
Absolutely. Do we have a TOC rate? No, I'm terribly sorry. That's for future expansion, Richard.
No ETAs, no guarantees.
No. Absolutely.
Don't promise that one.
So, moving right along, because we're still only halfway down page two.
That's good. We've got plenty of time. Don't worry. Yeah. Take your time, Dav.
Absolutely. So, Commander Danny Squid asks, can we have the look and the audio of stations and settlements change depending on system states? We've got nothing to announce today, and I haven't even got anything to say we're talking about it, but we already changed the decoration of planet bases based on the superpower that owns them. So if, for example, a Alliance faction takes over a settlement on a planet's base, the decals will change to the Alliance logo.
Oh, very nice. So subtle, but so that's something that's going in, did you say?
That has already been in since, I think, the release of Horizons, actually.
Well, now I feel
since
like
release 2.0. But, yes, so there are physical representations of shifting political currents in the galaxy.
But nothing else to announce.
But nothing else at the moment, but... So. Planet bases and decorations. Mm-hmm. So, Commander Veep and Commander Mark Hicks asked about security levels changing based on player actions. And the answer is yes. Star System does have a default security level. So, for example, the Sol System has got a very high security level, whereas a small outpost in the middle of space might have a very low security level by default. But depending on what faction states are going on, then the security level will change, and there will be effects of that security level changing on, for example, the rate of piracy, the authority responses, and even some commodity prices. But yes, it does change upon player activity. Commander Saul asks, is there a maximum number of factions that can retreat from a given system? The answer is yes. A faction cannot retreat if there are less than 4 factions in a given system. That way, we don't end up depopulating the entire galaxy. Thank you, Fiery Toad, for plugging the presentation. I will be referring to that a bit later on. There will not be time to rehash that conference talk.
Can I just show off about my jump range really quickly?
Yeah, do it.
50 light years, carry on.
50 light years on an ASP.
On an ASP Explorer. What? It's an engineered module.
Do I want to know
what? This is my real proper account.
Do I really want to know what you're fueling that ship with?
No. Also, I'm closing in on elite in exploration. Sorry, carry on.
No, that's quite a
somebody wanted to see something epic, and I think that's epic.
I think that's pretty epic to do that in an ASP. We've seen anacondas with jump ranges that big, but
an ASP exploder.
Can I explain why one system out by Barnard's Loop is independent and a medium security level? So Dave Skills Gaming, I don't know which system you're talking about, but I'm going to take a bit of a wild stab in the dark and suspect that there is a planet base in that system. That means there will be a population and a faction will have a presence there. So yes, not all of the population is centred upon Sol or upon Colonia. There are a few outposts of humanity in the deep reaches of space. Some of them I don't think people have discovered yet. So, moving right along, Commander Vectron asks about some oddities on the galaxy map. In particular, why does some zero population system have factions? So that was an amazing segue there, so thank you, chat channel. That really was literally next on the list. So the short answer is that they shouldn't do. Systems should only have factions if there's population in there. And Commander Vectron gave us a couple of examples. The first was that Siam Draconis has a faction and no population. And it arguably probably shouldn't have a faction in there because there's nothing in it. And the other question was, there is a Alliance research base called McTurner Base out in the California sector, and that has a population of zero on the galaxy map, but when you view it on the system map, there is population. I'm terribly sorry to say that that is a display bug with the galaxy map, and my colleague Tyler fixed that just the other day, but because that involves a game client update.
Sorry to say that.
I'm sorry to say
that. I'm going to ruin your fun.
That galaxy map will have to live with the display bug until the next release. But the servers know its population, and it's not affecting the power play values that are derived from population. Those are all stored in the server, and they're not affected by the display bug. I really hope not, Commander the Duckster 369.
What's the question?
Am I going to get fired for doing this live stream?
You went around asking everybody permission.
I really did.
Indeed, yes.
So Commander Vectron also asks about some impossible combinations that he'd seen on the galaxy map of superpower and government type. Mm. That does sound like a bug to me. We shouldn't have any federal feudal factions in the galaxy. I had a quick look in the database and there aren't any, so it shouldn't have displayed. But he did ask whether it's possible to force a complete refresh of the server's galaxy map data as part of the weekly maintenance. And the answer is yes, we do, as part of the weekly maintenance, immediately after power play has exerted its influence, and also during the daily background simtick. That's when the servers update the galaxy map overlays. So when a faction takes over ownership of a star system and it needs to change from, I don't know, for example, from independent to empire, then the colour of the dot on the galaxy map will change as part of that. And Commander Apos asks us, do we have any interesting statistics on how many star systems are controlled by which superpower now, as compared to at launch? So I cannot possibly give out absolute numbers of star systems and factions, but we can talk about relative percentages, just to look at the
relative
balance of
percentages. Everyone's the most exciting phrase.
Absolutely.
Relative percentages.
This is where we break out the stats.
I like it. Go on.
And if I keep talking, Ed might get his cue.
Go on. Yeah, keep going.
To look at...
Oh, I got it. Say it. Do the cue again.
Okay, so he asked about whether we had any statistics on superpowers and how that might have changed over since the lifetime of the game.
Well, funny you should say that, actually.
Oh, really?
We prepared this. I say we. I can't take any credit for this. Bam!
Here's one we prepared earlier.
All right, there you go. Graph!
I'm afraid, Commander Brusilov, you'll have to use the video on demand for the short recap from the start.
Sorry.
So,
there is no way of doing a short recap at this point.
No, it'd be far too fast. Yeah. Anyway, so the graphs that we're looking at are that the pie chart on the left is... Well, of course, I can't display that now.
There.
Oh, yes. So we can see that the balance of power is roughly the same as what it was when the game first launched, but the Alliance has slightly increased. But, and this is the interesting but, well over a third of star systems are no longer controlled by their default superpower, which means that whilst the balance of power hasn't changed, the actual face of galactic politics really, really has changed. Mm. So it really is a dynamic galaxy and the players are really making their presence felt.
Wow.
Yeah. Anyway, moving right along, let's make that go away before somebody catches us.
Oh, really? Is that a bit naughty? I liked it. All right, someone screen grab it. Bye.
Okay.
Oh, hello.
So factions. Mm-hmm. Factions and conflicts. Absolutely. So, conflicts. So, one of the frequently asked questions from many commanders, so apologies for the lack of attribution for this question here, was factions in conflict leech influence from other factions since 2.2? The answer is kind of, and this is where I might need some help from Ed again here.
Uh-oh, I wasn't listening again.
No, okay. So
that's so rude, I'm so sorry. I was trying to do the galaxy map, and I do apologise. It's like trying to play...
I must admit, the galaxy map is a lot nicer to look at than entirely hypothetical illustrations.
I'm being flippant in a jokey way. I am really listening to Dav, I promise. I'm not being a flippant idiot.
Absolutely.
I am.
So, anyway, the question was, what happened to factions in conflict since the release of 2.2? Yeah. So the short answer is that we were able to remove one of the checks and balances inside the game, which means that... rather than locking faction influence in a system to those that are in conflict, when two factions are at war and you affect their influence, they now have equal and opposite reactions rather than both going up or both going down, which means that if I hand in 5 combat bonds for this faction, the other one goes down by the equivalent of 5 combat bonds. However, we must remember that all influence levels must add up to 100%.
Okay.
So if we look at a quick illustration of 100%, that one. Click.
That's not what the image is called on my screen.
It says 100.
It does say 100. Okay, there you go.
There we go. Right, so all factions must add up to 100%. So even though influences are going up and down by equal and opposite reactions, not every action can have an opposite. So, for example, an assassination mission might be difficult to have to directly counteract. So because of this, through no fault of its own, a faction that's quite merely minding its own business might change based on other factions in that system.
Okay.
And we've got a better illustration of that in a different graph.
Which is?
Influence changes.
Thank you. There you go.
Numbers!
Do that again for me without that on the screen. Do it again.
What?
Well, you got so excited about numbers.
Numbers! I fully expect that to be gift by the end of this live stream.
Do you get excited by numbers? You like numbers?
No. I've got computers to handle numbers
okay,
for me.
Yeah,
it's just a case of being a puppet master.
Yeah, keep it going.
Great Scott. Yes, thank you, Mechagen. Okay, so the example that I've thrown up on screen here shows that factions A and B are at war. They have an equal and opposite reaction of one of them's clearly about to win. And in an ideal world, they will go up and they will go up, but the whole thing will add up to more than 100%. But by the time we're finished, I've been completely distracted by the live stream. Stop looking at the live stream.
You're looking at the chat now. Go on.
Absolutely. So we look at the inputs to say, well, actually, faction A would prefer to be 25 and faction B would prefer to be 20.
Yeah.
But because faction C is trying to get up to 44, they actually don't go to quite where they ended up because it all adds up to 100%. So if you look at that, faction D, through no fault of its own, has gone down by a couple of percent simply because all of the other factions are doing their thing in that system.
Right.
It's all got to add up to 100%. And that's what happens when people say, my faction has had something leached off it. It kind of has and it kind of hasn't. The player actions are still just for that faction. It is all working, but somebody else was also active in that star system.
Okay.
Right, let's get rid of that.
My head hurts a little bit, but that's because I don't understand numbers quite as well as maybe you do or other people. But
that's why we have programs to do it for us. It would take me years to calculate this lot by hand, and it wouldn't be the right answer.
That's number wang.
This is
Bertonius and Brad here. Number wang.
Truly is.
Yeah. Pressing right along.
So, many people have asked about the life cycle of a conflict, in particular reporting conflicts that start immediately after ending inside the same star system. And that brings us neatly along to Commander Honor Dawn's comprehensive nudge about an excellent bug report about multiple conflicts being triggered when it really shouldn't have been. So the good news for that is that, yes, it was a bug, and I finally squashed it this afternoon. It was new in release 1.4.
Well squashed.
Absolutely. So... moving on.
Yeah.
So people who have reported about a conflict starting, as in a conflict appearing pending, during the last tick of a conflict closing down, yes, that was not correct. And yes, it only happened in the star system it was triggered in. And yes, it only happened if one of the factions in conflict changed rank in that star system, as in its position along the influence charts. It's one of those bugs that was only a line to fix, but takes half an hour to explain. So thank you to everybody who pointed that out.
sounded sincere.
I did mean it, because nobody likes having bugs in their own code, especially when it affects so many people.
Sure.
So, yes. We never admit to bugs on air, but all right. However, moving on. So, lots of people asked about why do conflicts still appear to be present for about a day after the winner is decided? And the short answer is that there's two reasons. The first is that if you've got a few million people at war, it can take a while for the message to get around to all of them, that for them the war is now over. So there's a certain amount of context involved. But also there's a technical limitation. The background sim cannot keep running and running and running. It has to stop sooner or later. And it does the cleanup the next day. So that's why people who say, why have I still got a war active for one turn? It's partly for technical reasons. Missions given when there is a ceasefire, Commander Plater. Believe it or not, that conversation comes up in the office most weeks. The short answer is that they shouldn't, but there will be a very small amount of overlap, just because it takes a while for us to tell all of the servers that that particular faction in that particular star system is no longer at war. There is a certain amount of message propagation delay going on, but we try our best to minimise it, and it is a very, very frequently asked question, and yes, we are aware of it. Right, conflicts.
This is wonderful, by the way, Dan.
Absolutely. Here, I'll just drop a pencil on the floor. Sorry. Lean out of shot.
Don't worry, you've only got four times the amount of pages.
Commander T. Lee asks, there was a dev update on the forums from January 2016 with some numbers. Why do some conflicts stop after 4 days instead of running for 28 days? And this is a reasonably frequently asked question. People say, oh, well, why did my conflict stop after 6 days with no clear winner? The short answer is because there was no clear winner. All we've said is that a state can have a minimum duration and a maximum duration. A state does not necessarily run for its full maximum duration. And they generally don't. So that's that. It's not every war will always last 28 days before we get a ceasefire. Otherwise, nothing would happen on the galaxy because conflicts would just lock everything up. So, that's conflicts.
Oh, it sounds as if you've built a complicated thing here, Dav, to be honest.
What do you mean, me? There's a very, very large team of people.
I mean you representing...
Us as in Frontier Development, yeah. Yes, we have built a pretty complicated
beast
game. And we're pretty proud of it.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's talk a little bit about trade. And this is where we need to brace for impact.
Uh-oh.
A little bit.
Really?
Yeah, well, it's already been a frequently asked question in the chat channel.
Okay, sure.
So what felt like half of Reddit has been asking us about trading in single units to exaggerate the effects on the faction's owner, on the market's owner. So the short answer to this, and there is a long answer which I'm not prepared to give this evening, I'm afraid. So I do need to address this because it's a very, very frequently asked question. But single unit trading and people using it to artificially inflate the effect on the background sim, it's not ideal. We have a few short and long-term ideas about it. We are actively talking about it. It is under active consideration, but I have absolutely nothing to announce today.
Okay.
But we hear you loud and clear. Trust us. The other question on that one is, commanders who are consistently using macros to automate long-running tasks whilst they're away from the keyboard can expect bad news in the post from our support team.
Uh-oh.
And again, that's I'm afraid all I can say on that subject.
Okay, sure.
So, moving right along, Commander Limoncello Lizard asks, is it intentional that the rare goods trade is now affected by the background sim? He did use a slightly more exaggerated word, but the point there is, how does a background simulation affect trade markets?
Okay.
And the short answer is that faction states do have an effect on the commodity markets. So if it's in a boom, then there will be a lot more profit available, there'll be a lot more supply available. If there's a famine, I wouldn't expect to be buying any food anytime soon. And likewise, if there's a famine, the faction won't be paying top credits for personal weapons. They'll be paying top credits for foodstuffs.
Okay.
And that affects the rare goods just as much as it affects the rest of the trade commodities. The one exception to that is the rare goods that are used to unlock certain engineers. We've made sure that the gameplay is not completely blocked based on, for example, a faction lockdown. So, yes, it is entirely intentional that the rare goods trade is affected by the background simulation. It's a dynamic galaxy, after all. It'd be no fun if it was the same all the time.
There you go.
Okay, so
said from the
absolutely. Yeah, so next, Commander Phenox and Commander Kuki 1970. Apologies if I mispronounced that. What are our thoughts on different security levels by, sorry, differentiating different security levels by allowing goods in a lower security level system to have prices further from the galactic average? So in a low security system, there might be more profit margin available. Yeah, we agree completely. And the design change to that, I think, in release 2.1, which means if you're a trader and you like nice, safe and secure trading, then you might make less profit margin by trading between high security systems than trading between low security systems. But that you've got that extra bit of a hazard because there's maybe more chance of being interdicted, less chance of the police coming to your rescue.
So you're saying, good point.
Good
That's
point.
Why
good
we
point.
Did it.
That's why we did it. But it is in the game and has been since Great. Release 2.1.
Excellent.
So trading between security levels, it's definitely a thing.
Cool.
Right. So Commander Ben Ryder asks, what is the logic behind the presence of a black market being displayed on the system maps as a service? It used to be hidden once upon a time when we first launched the game, but trying to find a black market, especially when they appear and disappear based on who controls the market, was deemed to be too difficult and too obscure, so we added it to the system map. That's one thing where its quality of life for the players was more important than context.
Good question.
Absolutely.
From Simon Scott there as well.
Simon Scott, so he says, if a community goal
has led to the election of the wrong president, can the BGS be rolled back?
Rolling back the background simulation would require...
This is brilliant, a brilliant metaphorical answer. Go on, what would it require? Very difficult.
That would be quite a long weekly maintenance period and some extremely busy database servers.
Okay.
And probably pizza.
It's unfortunate. So yes. Unfortunately, it sounds like that's a no.
No.
Okay.
No, background sim runs forward.
Good.
And I'm not even going to say that we could roll it backwards. So, a couple of commanders have asked, how do we track down commodities? And this is either when I'm trading something, or I've got something to sell from some salvage, or I've got a mission to go and source some commodities. I'm not going to get this 100% correct, because I don't know the mission system particularly well, and my colleagues on the missions team will... berate me if I get this wrong.
I mean, Adam's in the chat, so just be careful.
Indeed. So, but I believe that missions generally demand goods that are in demand at that market, which means you should be able to use the Galaxy Maps supply and demand trade routes to source where to sell, where to buy goods from, and where to sell goods from. When I'm playing the game myself and I'm doing some trading, for example, I've got a Type 6 kitted out for trading. Make about, I don't know, 180,000 credits a run, something like that, my little Type 6. I only ever use the Galaxy map and the display on the commodities market for what is imported from where, what is exported to where, and what the economy types are of the markets in those systems.
Okay.
So the data are in there.
What Dasa was correct, said Adam White.
Thank goodness for that. Thank you, Adam. Which means,
nice to know, isn't it?
So, and the other question was, there was a concern about by the time they get there, there's nothing available in stock to buy. AI traders always leave at least 25% of the produced commodities available for players to buy, or 25% of the available demand for you to satisfy. Mm-hmm. So if there's nothing in stock, that's either because other players have bought it all, or there's a faction state going on, for instance, that's made it go away.
Hi, Fred. Makes a comment there.
This is not working 100%. It's a big galaxy. If there is a specific example that you spotted isn't working 100%, please do let us know. We try our best to keep an eye on the bug report forums, but specific concrete examples of, I go here, I want to look at that, this piece of data is displayed between these systems and it shouldn't be there. Absolutely, please do let us know in the bug report forums. We will look at it and we will try our best to address it.
Yeah.
Obviously, that's balanced with developing the rest of it.
Aspetaria says it's not that they're wrong, it's just that they don't guarantee a profit. I think that's the...
Yes, they absolutely don't guarantee a profit. Yeah. They are...
That's the important...
Absolutely. The trade route data are based on the underlying economic simulation of the galaxy, but they're also based upon player activity. That's why they're rebuilt every day, based on literally what players have bought where and sold where. Which means that if players are doing something that isn't at a profit, it's still a trade route. People are still doing it, therefore it's valid.
Can I ask you a quick question about things? Yeah, actually, Classic Gamer NL says it is eddb.io. Don't you know if you've been on that one?
I have.
Database.
I'm afraid I do not know what that is, so therefore I cannot comment on it one way or another.
Sure.
I have no context with which to base an opinion.
I can give you some context if you wish.
I also don't have an opinion on what our terms of service are. I'm afraid I haven't memorised
them. Okay. It's not about the legality of it, I mean, but what do you think of those sort of third-party tools that help people with trade and stuff like that? Is that sort of thing?
So I don't have an opinion on them.
Dooney does not have an opinion. No opinions from Dav about eddb.io. Okay.
Absolutely.
I feel like have I angered the Dav?
No, not at all. You can't anger the Dav.
You can't anger
the Dav. Really can't.
All right. Hey, I found a neutron star.
You found a neutron star? I love looking at neutron stars. They're so pretty.
Some of them are so crazily different as well.
I know.
I saw a beautiful one the other day where the... It is legal as it uses the API commander log. Thank God, Rick. Where we had... there was a... Just a quick pause so you can have a drink of water. Take just a moment.
Wet towels, you know.
Wet towels, you're just out. Yeah, just calm down. There was a sort of lens flare effect across. So you had the sort of vertical stripe of the waving flare.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had a lens flare exactly cutting it in half as well. I took a screenshot. I'll post it on Twitter later on tonight.
Definitely.
Anyway, as you were.
No,
that's
absolutely.
Enough of a break. Too much break.
Damn
Carry
it.
On.
It's watching the neutron stars is so hypnotic. It's a beautiful piece of artwork. Yeah.
Plumes.
Absolutely. Which is why I'm so grateful that Elite Dangerous isn't just server programmers.
Yeah.
Otherwise we wouldn't have pretty stuff like that. So
imagine. It's a text-based adventure. Anyway, go on.
Commander Red Stickers Hurt asks, can we please have a bigger ship for trading? The Imperial Cutter can fit, 790 units in its cargo hold? How much cargo are you planning on carrying? And how are you going to get that through the letterbox? Kind of posting them one at a time? Yeah. Commander Keytrax asks, how come certain commodities can sometimes be found at certain stations, but at other times not? And the example was given was personal weapons in this case, but also reactive armour and advanced medicines. They're simply not listed. So there's a difference between a commodity that is listed and has zero supply, or a commodity that has simply evaporated from the trade supply. And that is almost certainly to do with what's legal in that jurisdiction for the faction that controls that market. The examples given of personal weapons and reactive armour, they are illegal in most of the jurisdictions in the game. Obviously pirates and independent systems have a different opinion, a slightly more relaxed opinion about what's valid or not, or what's legal or not. Because you cannot openly buy illegal goods, they just disappear entirely from the supply and demand graphs. that's almost certainly what it was. It's not 100% what it was. It could easily be a nasty bug that we simply haven't spotted yet. But that's my best guess for why sometimes they just disappear.
Just doing 145 light year jump casually.
As you do. Yeah. I hope you didn't get whiplash.
I got a little bit. In fact, that's a bug of my modules. I took 1% damage, but that's okay.
Poor frameshift drive.
That's expected.
Absolutely. So... that was all the questions I got on trade and factions. So now's a good time to shift gear into technical.
Oh boy!
To technical mode.
Ladies and gentlemen, if it wasn't already dense enough, here we go. Let's go. Technical stuff.
Absolutely. So before I want to address that, GIF has asked the question about many market commodities being useless. People trade only expensive goods.
Hi, Commander GIF, by the way.
Absolutely. So the question is, so profit margins on trading is a relative proportion of the commodity's value. If I'm a starting commander in the game and I've only got a couple of thousand credits and a cargo hold of four, I'm afraid I won't be able to fit my cargo hold out with superconductors and make, say, a 20% profit on that. Whereas I probably can make a significant profit, and it's actually more by percentage on the lower value goods, by using the lower value goods. They are in the game for a reason, not just for colour. And the profit margins are actually bigger on most of the lower value items. So they are there, they're just not there for everybody. Obviously, when I'm driving around in a Type 7 or a Type 9, I've got plenty of credits to spend, then yes, absolutely, Progenitor sells one way and reactive armor the other way, and I'll be maximizing my absolute profit margin. But it takes a while to get there.
So here goes the technical.
Absolutely.
Take it away.
Can we have the Type 9 as manoeuvrable as an ASP? I think you'd tear its engines off if we tried that. It sounds like a good game to play in beta, though. Okay, so networking and instancing, and this is where we really do need the lab coat. Because this is another very popular, frequently asked question.
Are people bracing for this one, or are we...
It's not a very controversial one, it's just a very popular question. Okay. And by popular, I mean lots of people have asked it. Many commanders have asked is, can I provide a technical explanation for the gameplay needing to be frozen during transitions, such as dropping out a super cruise, an orbital cruise, and can it please go away? Which is, that was a perfect illustration from Ed Lewis just then. Absolutely, yes, changing between star systems. Yeah. So yes, there is a technical explanation. It's a loading screen. And I'm sure my colleagues will really not be impressed with me saying that. But one of the things that people say is waiting for servers and instances when hopping into an outer supercruise, when arriving at a space station or leaving orbital cruise to get near a planet's surface. Mm. Yes, there is some time waiting on server data, but it's a relatively small percentage of the time there. And the gameplay has to be frozen because we have to have a consistent state involved. I'm afraid I can't get into too much more detail because I'm not a gameplay programmer, and some programmers who are much, much cleverer than me will just tell me that I got it wrong. But yes, there is a reason for it, and it isn't instancing.
Yep.
However, we can talk a little bit about instancing.
Sorry, I'm just about to go to the loading screen, so...
Absolutely. No, that's fine. whilst you're on that, sir.
Oh, it's a lovely. It's beautiful, right? I can look around in it. And
absolutely.
Yeah.
Potentially changing between matchmaking server instances. Getting the system state of the system you're arriving at.
Potentially loading assets. Generating something for the first time as well, perhaps.
It only takes a few dozen milliseconds, but yes.
Oh, okay.
But right, potentially loading up some graphics from your hard disk. Anyway, loading screen. Yeah. However, lots of people have asked questions along the lines of, how does instancing work? Why do we think instancing is so bad? As in, what symptoms, what bad player experience have we had that leads us to suspect this is causing us woe? And why does it not always happen seamlessly? And for that, we have a very brief demonstration.
Oh, great. I'll cancel that.
Cancel that.
I will slow down.
Absolutely.
Because I don't want to get... So this is the best thing you will ever see.
So
first of all, before we...
So the first thing that we're going to mention here is that I'm going to give you an introduction to this, is that when I've needed to hand wave how dynamic instancing works, I've done it by, say, people are flying around and when they get within visual range, the servers introduce them to each other so that you can see each other and interact with each other. So this is how, if you've got, I don't know, a large number of people gathering outside a space station or on a planet's surface, all they have to do is fly to the same place. The game will notice that they're in the same place and they'll introduce them, and there is no loading screen for that introduction. However, hand-waving it isn't always the best illustration.
But
here's one we made earlier, and by made earlier, I mean something like 2 and a bit years ago. This is a...
to illustrate to internally.
Absolutely. So this is an internal illustration of how our matchmaking system works.
Oh, there's player one, player
absolutely.
Two, player three, so they're waiting.
We've got visual range. We've got players flying around in space. As soon as they get within visual range, we'll introduce them to each other. You can see each other in the game. You can interact with each other directly. Then they get out of visual range, and then they simply go on their merry way. And that's how our dynamic instances work. It's very lightweight and it's very, very dynamic. All they have to be is on the same server in order to do that.
Okay.
That's it. It can go away again now.
Mesmerised by it.
Don't be. This is the reason why I don't do graphics. And one of my colleagues, the head of UI, is going to be very sad with me in the morning because he did build me a wonderfully pretty illustration of this and I couldn't find it.
Aww, is that John?
Yes. John. Absolutely. So that is how it works all day, every day for all of our interactions. I don't think I could even estimate how many times a day that runs. It's very, very large numbers.
Yes.
And it does work reasonably well. We are happy and confident with it working.
And yeah, no, fantastic. I did have a question that I'm going to have to remember what it was, but it was, of course, relevant to that very thing.
Yes.
Very frustrating. All right, sorry. Thank you, chat, by the way, for being here. Oh, that's what I wanted to say really, really quickly.
Yes.
Once again, is, can I just say, I'm not sure that any other developer to blow our own trumpets in some ways, would do a live stream like this where we come on and explain these things in this level of detail. This is specifically for our core audience.
Yes.
You guys in the community, we know that you care about this sort of stuff and want to know about the inside workings of these things. So do say thank you to Dav for taking up his own time doing that, coming on here one more time. I know that we already have, but seriously, massive thank you to Dav for coming along and doing this.
I would say this information is niche. It's not going to be of the interest to the majority of our players.
Exactly, but it's also, you know, it's kind of behind the curtain a little bit.
Yeah, a little
which
bit.
Which we need to, you know, well, tighten up a little. But
yeah, yeah,
we do appreciate
absolutely.
It. Thank you. Good.
We'll find out how it goes, but whether we'll have to do another.
Thanks,
one.
Thanks, Dav. There you go. That's what I just wanted. I just wanted to see some quick thanks to.
So Dav. Somebody briefly before that scrolled off screen asked, why don't we have an instance the size of an entire star system? Because you can't see it. Is a short answer. We use visual range for a reason. So in terms of actual physical geometry, a supercruise session is going to be hundreds of light seconds across, whereas if I'm just slow boating outside Leif Station, it's going to be, I don't know, on the order of 50 kilometres, something like that, maybe.
Look how much love you're getting there. It's
Famous.
Thank you for the love, everybody.
Right, so we need to move right along or we'll still be here because we're running a little bit low on time.
It's all right, well.
So Commander Veep asks a straightforward question. Why do player ships vanish immediately upon losing connection? And the short answer is the player-to-player connection drops and therefore non-transferable game objects disappear from the game because we can't fling authority.
Okay.
So it moves quite neatly on from that instancing thing. Once the player is no longer in the game, they can no longer assert their state in a safe way. So, Commanders C3 Geekio and Rahail asks, is there anything in the immediate future to further help the stability of instancing and connection errors? And I'm going to kind of take that to be a slightly more wider thing here to talk about a piece of work that a number of our colleagues have been working on recently. Just before Christmas, in fact. So, we actually spend a fair amount of time working with certain player groups to understand some of the most commonly experienced problems that remain with matchmaking, and with their help we've managed to close a number of different classes of problems when things just haven't worked as well as they should. It could be something like a wing moving between star systems, or people in a wing in Australia trying to meet up with somebody in North America. That wasn't working particularly well, and we got that hot fixed out to the live game in early December.
Oh, amazing.
So we are working on this all the time. Other issues that couldn't be addressed as a server hotfix, such as a number of net traversal issues, were fixed in the most recent patch, 2.2.03.
Yeah.
Another fix to do with changing IP addresses mid-session. That was hotfixed out this morning. So we really are working on matchmaking connection issues, and where we know about an issue and can understand it and at least attempt to reproduce it, either in-house or based on network logs that have been sent in, then yes, we are absolutely working on them, and we are working on them all the time.
Yeah, including things, because a few questions about wings, I'm not sure if you're covering any
wings
stuff at all in here.
Wings are the strongest signal for putting people into the same instance. Right. There should be nothing else stronger than a wing. So if people are in a wing, the servers basically ignore almost all of their rules and say, you will be in one instance on that server, we're gonna bust every gut we have.
Sure.
We bust over server load capacity limits, we bust over geographic boundaries. If you're in a wing, we're trying as hard as we can to put together, which means that when it fails, it's kind of difficult to debug. But there are tools in the game that help us do it. So when people submit a bug report to us on the forums and say, I was in a wing with this person and I was hopping into and out of supercruise and we couldn't quite meet up. In order for us to debug that effectively, what we would really, really love is really verbose net logs, and there's a way of changing your app config file to create these net logs,
ooh,
of both parties that were in that wing, or all four people if it's a big wing. However, there is also a debug tool, a diagnostic that was added in patch 2.2.03 that will also help us. So if you have had a wing instancing trouble,
this is good news,
and you've submitted a bug report, then please use Ctrl-Alt-L.
Oh, hello.
Which
is coming up on, because we're on stream.
Stick it over there.
You put something up on the screen of...
What have I done?
In there.
Oh, yeah. Anyway.
Which I've never seen before, so
that was awesome.
That.
Anyway, click on the game client.
Click on the game client, there you go.
And we do Ctrl-Alt-L.
There you go, yeah. Oh, it's coming up there again.
There we go. Network bookmark.
That's weird.
Absolutely.
Why is it doing it on there, but not on
so,
there?
Inside the game, Ctrl-Alt-L, I think, and my colleague Howard will probably correct me if I've got that wrong.
It's nice to me that it didn't come up on that screen, but it came up and...
I blame it's probably just off the bottom. Anyway, what this tool does is it gives us a network diagnostic behind the scenes that we can use to check the server state at that point with your network logs, and that gives us a much stronger chance of finding out why your wing didn't work for us. So obviously that's not for everybody. That's why it's a hidden hotkey. But if you consistently haven't got wings working for you, and you've got and you're willing to help us debug it, please use these tools for us. We really are here and listening.
Cyber Sorcerer does have a good point. What about on Xbox One?
I don't know.
It's a good question.
It's a very good question.
Yeah, we'll try for maybe we put together a little bit of a forum post about it that's locked away in some deep some bug forum report. Or are you already being too naughty by saying this?
I don't know.
All right. Okay.
Thank you. How to control L? Should we try that?
Control L.
It just says network bookmark again.
So is that the same one? Is that the right one? Is that the right one you wanted?
I have no idea. Anyway, normally what it displays on the on the screen is that there's a diagnostic and an ID. Anyway, so that's a tool that is, it's for advanced users only, but it really does help us behind the scenes. Please don't just spam it for the heck of it. That does go into our... Anyway, moving on. So...
Be good with that knowledge.
So,
great power comes great responsibility, ladies and gentlemen.
Absolutely. So, one of the biggest... challenges that we've had with getting people into instances, and this is why a number of people have said, well, that's all what you've said on Steam is all well and good, but why doesn't that work for me? Why do I not have a great experience? And one of the possible reasons is to do with NAT traversal, which is an interesting subject in and of itself, and I won't go there because I will get it wrong and then people will become sad with me. But from my point of view, IPv6 should of course help some of these problems go away. Although it does, of course, introduce some of its own complexities. I can't say more about Elite Dangerous and support of IPv6, but I will say that we are currently experimenting with it. Nothing to announce, but we are working on it, and we do think it will help in certain places, and probably hinder in others, because it's a complicated family of addresses, after all. A few other people have asked, how do we get people into the same instance? If it doesn't happen naturally, wings are probably your best bet. But there are a number of tiebreakers for getting people into an instance with you if you're not using wings, such as if you're friends with them, whether you've encountered them recently, whether you've got them on your block list, things like that. But if you're in the same area of space and you're in the same private group and your peer-to-peer network connection is working flawlessly and the space in your instance and you're definitely in the right area of space, then chances are you will meet up with somebody else. Please don't try and use wings to pack too many people into an island. You will find instances on the internet where people have gone crazy.
Yes,
that doesn't necessarily... It might sound like a fun idea, but it means that your instance is very much vulnerable to just one person's internet connection not being as great as everybody else's. It might be great, but just not as great as everybody else's, which means you may get a poor experience, which is why we have a number of health checks behind the scenes to look at whether somebody's particularly laggy or somebody has a large number of drop packets. And if that's slowing everything down, then the matchmaking system will consider that.
Good question from Osric. I don't know if that's something you can answer, to be honest. So read
speaking
it first.
Of the block list, can it be changed so that you don't have to friend someone first before you can block them? I am afraid I cannot comment on that because this is not my department.
But it's a good question.
It is a very good question to get into your minds.
Yep.
And again, I won't mention what may or may not be in our internal to-do list system.
Okay, wonderful.
But yes, it is an excellent question. And it would help considerably with certain support issues as well as just an in-game mechanic.
So it sounds like it would be a useful thing for us to do.
I'm not in charge of what we do when.
Okay.
I'm absolutely confident that there are a large number of more important things to do.
Dav Safety Stott. You will never say... Although, you've been...
As brave as I can get away.
You've been very brave tonight.
So,
keep being brave.
Commander Brill Pilot has asked us some really juicy networking questions, most of which I'm not able to answer. Sorry. However, he did ask us what our top networking frustrations are. He did ask for a top three set of networking frustrations, but I, at the moment I only have two. NAT, or carrier grade NAT, and lack of 100% support of IPv6 across the entire internet. Oh, and off by 1 hour.
Very nice.
Commander Dark Matter Generator has asked, why am I sometimes stuck without a CQC match for over an hour despite sitting in the queues? Unfortunately, it depends on who else is also in the queues at the time and who else is there. We can say that team objective or capture the flag isn't always as popular as the other ones. But maybe if you're playing CQC and you're waiting in the queue, maybe show some capture the flag some love, and some other players might
jump in as well.
Might jump in as well. But yes, it is just dependent on the number of other players waiting to join in.
Come along to watch when we play on Thursdays with CQC. Like, at certain times it's more popular than others. When we do CQC on Thursdays sometimes here,
it's good fun.
It's usually a lot of people get in, and it is a lot of fun. So do come along if you want to do like a CQC. We do on 7 p.m. GMT on Thursdays, and you can usually get in a game there because lots of people come in. So do, you know. And it is great when it works.
It really is good fun, so, anyway. CQC. I do love playing a bit of CQC myself. Not very good at it, but it's still fun.
I completely feel everyone's playing on that.
Absolutely. So Commander Equinox asks, and again I need to be a little bit cautious because I noticed Adam was in the chat, are there any server-related reasons for the amount of available missions being relatively low? Does the game request information from the servers on opening system map, galaxy map, or mission board? Is this data cacheable or otherwise possible to optimise? That's a big question, let's break it down a bit. So the first question is, so presumably he is consistently experienced, not very many missions available for him at a particular system. Now, there might be design reasons for that. There might be plenty of missions available for other players in that system, but not for him. There might be some faction state reasons why there aren't any available for you. The mission generators may simply not be within reach. So, for example, if I'm somewhere like Maya or Robigo, there's not going to be very many short-range missions, so the generator won't succeed at doing that. Likewise, who knows what the passenger's mission generator may come up with. So there may not be that many missions there. However, in the most recent release, we have spent some time, and I think this was one of Dom's changes in release 2.2, to do what we can with the server system to only send missions that are as relevant as possible for the mission board or for the passenger lounge. Likewise, our core programmers, who, trust me, these are really, really good programmers, have made some networking changes that mean that it's faster for us to transmit the mission data from the servers down to the game client. Because previously, people with high ping, such as people who have satellite internet connections, were often unable to get them in time, simply because it took that long for the network packet acknowledgement to get back to the server to say, yes, send us another one. Loads of bandwidth, but high latency. So yes, we are actively working on that, and we really do want to get as many missions into your hands as possible. For us, a mission board currently takes about 10 to 11 seconds to send the data down mostly, and that's significantly improved. We are working on it all the time, but that's where it's at the moment. So that's missions. The other question was, does the game request information on the system map? The answer is yes. When you open the system map, it does go and fetch a bit of server data for what factions are in that system. But that takes on the order of maybe 100, 150 milliseconds. So the rest of the time spent starting the system map isn't necessarily blocked on server data. Not unless you're playing on a GSM dial-up modem or something, at which point we've got bigger problems. ISOKIX asks for a packet, whether it's TCP/IP or UDP. That is a most excellent segue. It's almost like I could have lined it up, because the next thing I was going to talk about was servers.
Yay!
Talked about a bit about networking and instancing, but now let's talk a little bit about servers. Many people have asked about the network architecture, that our network architecture uses peer-to-peer as well as servers. I'm afraid there isn't enough time tonight to drill down into it, and there certainly isn't time for us to explain the rationale behind it. We hear that you asked us for it, but I'm afraid there's only so much time we can get into the live stream. And also, most of those decisions were made long before I moved on to the project, so I can't talk about it anyway. In general terms, though, we use peer-to-peer traffic where latency matters. We want to get the state of one person's ship, like, I don't know, the position of a missile or the shield strength, from one player to another as quickly as possible, so we cut out the middleman. Whereas when we have data that maybe we need to be a little bit more secure about it, like people's save state, or whether we need to share that data around, then we use some of the server connections. That's why we have a hybrid architecture. A large number of people have asked about disconnection issues, and, oh sorry, Shadow Dance, is the stuff I described in the AWS talk reasonably valid? Yeah, pretty much. There's a few changes behind the scenes, but the architecture is still pretty much the same as it was back then.
Keep going, Dav, take time, don't worry.
Okay. So, a few players have asked about different disconnection issues, and this is quite a large question, so I'm going to read it out because it might be useful to some other people listening in the chat channel and watching the live stream back. There are several different reasons why the game disconnects, and I'm quoting from Commander Arguendo here, by the way. to attribution. There are several different reasons why the game disconnects you, and they are seemingly random, although when you experience one, there is always a greater chance of experiencing that same one again and again. From his side, he was getting a lot of matchmaking server errors until I configured my router to allow port forwarding, presumably instead of using hole punching or UPnP. For a while, he was suddenly experiencing a lot of adjudication server disconnects until I checked my ping and saw a lot of dropped packets. I then changed my Wi-Fi from 2.4 GHz to 5 GHz, the ping dropouts disappeared, and so did my adjudication server issues. The question is there a general guideline for what causes which server error, i.e. adjudication server is caused by packet loss? Knowing this would help players troubleshoot things on their side. So for those players that are really trying to understand what actions in the game are triggering what disconnection for them, we have prepared a little crib sheet
for
the different names of the different servers. Okay, because don't fly into a star, please.
Yeah, it's all right, there's
there's always time for a jump and a honk. So if we quickly segue off to, you can say never use Wi-Fi, but actually I use 5 GHz Wi-Fi at home. It's generally been okay for me.
It's very good.
But if I used 2.4 GHz and my phone had Bluetooth on, it was ropey as...
Poor Ed says Netslayer UK, don't worry, I'm lost too. Look, it's all right.
It's okay. It's all good. This isn't for everybody.
It's all good. No, but it's good.
Yeah. And Crikey72 asks for MTU. Absolutely. So this is another visual aid that was absolutely not typed out in PowerPoint 20 minutes before the live stream started. So there are four main names that you will see referred to in the game client, especially when we have disconnection messages. And we are fairly consistent about it. So when we say a server, and we'll get a bug report for, we have a server problem. Our first question is always going to be, was it matchmaking, adjudication, transaction, or authentication server? So matchmaking servers and adjudication servers use UDP. It's a similar connection mechanism to peer-to-peer. And in that case, yes, MTU matters, but we do measure the maximum MTU for your connection. So that is already taken care of by the game.
Yeah. Again.
This is conference talk presentation.
I like it a lot.
So the matchmaking server is used for obviously matchmaking with other players, and it handles other administrative tasks as well that I won't go into tonight because again it'll be here come Friday. And for that, it's kind of sensitive to latency, but a 20-second turnaround for one of those commands is still within the realms of tolerance. It's not brilliant. We clearly would like to turn it around in a few milliseconds, but latency is not a huge problem for matchmaking. But dropped packets can be if it's a particularly important packet that was dropped. Adjudication server, if you ever see that system, if that word appear, that's generally something to do with missions that's not worked well for you. That could be downloading a mission board for you at a station. It could be being given a mission in space, or it could be a mission state update. So for example, if somebody has done something we really strongly recommend you don't do and stacked a bunch of conflict missions, and they've just killed an NPC in a conflict zone, that suddenly means that we suddenly have 15 missions that all need a plus one adding to them within that same timeout. And if you've got a high latency or drop packet, then the adjudication server can struggle to get that turned around in time through that network connection. So adjudication server missions, and that is particularly pronounced when stacking missions, which means that when you do a plus one of a state, you have lots and lots of that plus ones all to get done at the same time. The transaction server is based on TCP, which means it's largely up to the operating system and the underlying network to transport for us. And we use that for significant state changes, such as I've docked, I've bought 5 units of fish, I've solved my type 9 and I'd quite like it back again. And that is not terribly sensitive to latency either. Although, again, we prefer ping time of less than 300 milliseconds. But a latency of 5 to 10 seconds for that would probably work. Haven't tested it. Would strongly recommend against it, but it should still function. And finally, there's the authentication server, which only ever runs as part of the login process before the main menu. Again, it's TCP, and that's really not sensitive to latency at all, because that's a relatively small number of requests. And as long as it turns around within 30 seconds, we should get there. How can you check my ping? Ping something on the internet, preferably something in Ireland. Not that that's where most of our servers live.
Don't go and destroy our servers in Ireland.
No. So
I'm starting to understand now why you asked around the office about if you were allowed to give this information away.
The information that I was just talking about was first announced at the Amazon
conference. You've talked about this stuff publicly before.
That stuff is, there is a talk on YouTube from
I think some maybe last one autumn, of our moderators before, can link it in the chat.
When Dave Walsh and myself gave a conference presentation on some of the cloud computing aspects of Elite Dangerous and some of the design mechanisms behind it and a lot of the business reasons behind it. There's all the detail in there. I won't give it now. It takes an hour to give and we're down to our last 20 minutes of live stream. So if you want all the information, there is some stuff there. Likewise, if you want loads of juicy numbers about factions and the background simulation, there is another video on demand on live stream of when Adam Bourke-Waite and myself talked a bit about that in gory detail.
And again, I sat there going,
what? So, yeah, there are numbers.
Yes. There you go. So Ian Phillips has posted it in there, as has Crash Landing as well. Thank you, Crash Landing.
Absolutely. So, yeah, so this is where half the audience tabs out to watch that.
No. Keep it bookmarked for later.
Absolutely. So if people want more detail about servers and scaling, that's where they are.
Fantastic.
However, as Commander Steph mentioned, it often feels counterintuitive to be told you've had a matchmaking server disconnection when you're playing in solo mode. Yes, absolutely true. When you're in solo mode, we're not matchmaking you with any other players, but we do still need that server connection for administration, such as telling you when you've ranked up, for example. We like to tell you when you've hit elite. We need a server connection to tell you that, and that's a matchmaking server job.
Interesting.
Absolutely. So Commander Sprox asks, and a couple of people in the chat channel who scrolled off, so I can't name your names, do all the matchmaking servers run it using Amazon Web Services? Do they auto-scale or do you run a fixed number? So all of our servers that run the live game do run using Amazon Web Services. The vast majority of them are based in one data center because latency around the world is not that significant for most of them. There are a few servers specifically to do with helping relay network traffic for the peer-to-peer connections. Some people call them turn servers, and those are really sensitive to latency. So we run those, again, using Amazon Web Services, but those are dotted around the world in lots of different data centers. But for the majority of the time,
I'm
they're all in one
notes.
Place.
I'm fascinated by them. carry on.
And yes, they absolutely do auto-scale. So on a Sunday night...
I knew that because I read his notes.
Absolutely. So on a Sunday night, we are going to have a lot more servers and CPUs running Elite Dangerous than we do, for example, at Half Past Eight on a Monday morning.
Okay.
So there is a very, very big difference. Yes, there's some auto-scaling going on there.
It's actually pretty incredible, actually, the difference.
Absolutely.
It's incredible how many people are... It sounds like I don't believe it, but still playing Elite Dangerous, like tons and more of you keep coming every day.
We've just released a rebalancing patch that seems quite popular.
Some mysterious things happening.
There are mysterious stories.
Mysterious goings on that.
Absolutely.
I don't know about that. Actually, no, I did. I spent some time with Canon and it was very...
Yeah, absolutely. Commander John Casey asks, how much space on the servers are our commanders using? So I'm not going to name actual storage numbers in gigabytes or millions of rows or anything like that, just because that's not a very interesting number, and because we've got players, it'll be out of data as soon as I say it. But I will say that we only store interesting data. It keeps things efficient, and everything, where possible, has a default state. Obviously, Commander save games don't have a default state, but the Galaxy does. If you want more details, have a look at that presentation that I'm busy shilling. So, lots of space.
Shilling.
Absolutely. So, Commander Gruenberg on Reddit asked if we could give a worked example of something that was really gnarly to debug, or something that seemed really easy on face value but then turned into a complete can of worms. So I'm not going to do a live debugging session because I think I would lose 3/4 of the live stream overnight.
Are you kidding? Do you mean it would take all night to do it?
It would take all night.
24-hour live stream for charity.
Debugging whilst you wait. No, that wouldn't be exciting for anybody, trust me. However...
You underestimate our audience.
There are times when debugging, you just have to get code on one screen and lots of data on one screen and lots of server logs on one screen and just stare at the matrix and do guru meditation for those Amiga players in the audience.
So look,
debugging live stream.
Ed would need coffee though, mate, stream.
I think Dav would need coffee. Watching somebody stare at the Matrix would not be very exciting. Yeah. So yes, sometimes debugging code is relatively straightforward. Sometimes it is really difficult to reproduce in-house. Some of the matchmaking ones that we're talking about have been a particular challenge recently, because that involves balancing three people's network logs with some server logs, with trying to memorize all of the different server state and codes that are interacting with to get it.
I love you guys so much. It's like, you can get them excited about a live debugging 24-hour live stream. They're like, yeah, do it, come on, yes, go!
Oh,
yeah.
Goodness. We do anyway. Definitely go through the six stages of debugging, though. This on. Can't happen. That doesn't happen on my machine. That shouldn't happen. Why does that happen? Oh, I see. Why did that ever work?
Why did
six
that
stages of debugging happens to every professional software developer on the planet.
Do it one more time?
No.
Oh.
Six stages of debugging.
No, it's refused.
I know. Absolutely. So, there was a question up there that was... scroll it up.
You scroll up for a bit?
Yeah, yep. there was a really good... Are there any settings on a local router or in a system config to get a better experience with instancing and speed of loading?
Good question.
It is a very good question. I don't think we have any frequently asked questions, because we strongly prefer that players use universal plug and play on their home routers. Some people have security concerns about that. We understand that, but it is the most common way of having UDP hole punching, and having that enabled is the most reliable way, and it is the way that we prefer. And I'm sure Howard will get in the chat channel and tell me if I've got that wrong. But in general terms, the defaults are there for a reason. They work best for the majority of players.
There you go.
Yes, so apologies for those players who didn't get their questions answered. There were pages and pages and pages of them. Some of them we've run out of. I keep a rubber duck on my desk. No, but I do have a stress globe on my desk.
Stress globe.
A stress globe. Absolutely.
And some discounted out-of-date Milky Ways as well.
Oh yes.
No, are they? They're not Milky Ways.
They're Milky Bars.
Milky Bars.
Yes, that was a metaphor that went too far and then got out of date. Yes, I really do need to dispose of those in hazmat waste.
I've eaten a few.
Absolutely.
Of them recently.
So we're going to wrap up a little bit now, because okay. We've been going on for an hour and 20 minutes. But I do want to address some of the players who did submit questions. We did read them all. Often multiple times over, as I tried to work out which order in the stream to put them in. A lot of them were off topic for tonight. A lot of them were areas that I can't really speak confidently about. A lot of it was about future plans, about design ideas.
Can I just really quickly say, Deep Brain Stimulation has been very polite, and he's always like, he's putting his hand up, he's saying, I have a question.
Okay.
And so I'm interested in Deep Brain Stimulation's question.
Okay, I'm Jen, okay.
Because he's been polite with his hand up, so better, if after all this...
He'd better be able to paste it into chat.
Exactly. And also, it better not be a waste of our time.
The time is there to be used. If it's of interest...
It's very polite. He's got his hand up in the back, like, please. Yeah.
Hello, Deep Brain Stimulation.
That's not a question. Thank you. He's just talking now. All right, sorry. So as you were saying,
absolutely.
Before we interrupted.
Absolutely. So apologies to those players who didn't get their questions answered. We did see the questions. It might not have been appropriate for me to answer them. It might not be something we could talk about. It might just have been off topic, or it might not have fitted in tonight and it would have needed a live stream in its own right. So please don't feel personally aggrieved. We tried our best to hit a balance. Mm.
The question has not appeared. So
you might just
really
be typing.
Long one, or...
Are there things out there that we don't know of still like secrets? If we told you about them, they wouldn't be secrets anymore. Absolutely. It is important. But content is there in the galaxy. It is a big galaxy, and I'm fairly sure people haven't found everything.
You've not found everything.
No.
Will Stevens says, will you upload this to YouTube promptly? It will automatically upload straight away as soon as the stream ends.
This is technical reasons. So we need to start wrapping up a little bit now. Hang on. Whoa, back it up. So Commander, I'm not going to try and pronounce that. If we sell explosives to an extraction station or crop harvesters to an agri station, will it influence the amount of goods produced, or is the production of goods population-based?
Ah.
It's a very good question, and it's actually one that comes up quite a lot, and it was one of the ones I was trying my best to gloss over, because a lot of people said, ooh, it would be a great idea if it did this, or wouldn't it be a nice idea of this, or would you like it to do this? Those are design questions which I can't speak to, but I can talk about implementation, and the amount of goods supplied or demanded by a given market is based on the population of that market. So a star system has a population. So in the case of Lave, it's got a gigantinormous population. If it's the case of the California sector system, it's got about 3 people in the cent. Markets have different sizes. The bigger the market, the more units of commodities are produced or consumed there. It is directly proportional to population. It's also directly proportional to about a dozen other signals, but population is also involved. Mm.
So we've got a couple of wrapping
we
up
have, absolutely.
Things to
so, bring up. So Commander FX asked, is the background sim hamster's name Bob? And I'm afraid we don't confirm or deny anything about the background sim hamster, but here's a picture of a guinea pig dressed as a chef's hat.
Wait, here it is.
There. So we don't talk about the background sim hamster ever. We don't confirm or deny anything. So Commander Thruster Bradford asks, do we really have a big red button that launches the servers? Yes, we do. And the video of David using it to launch version 1.0 of the game is on YouTube somewhere.
It's on YouTube, yeah. We do have on our proper account.
Absolutely, we do. We do have a big red button.
Yeah.
Commander Squared Specs asked, "What is Dav's favourite Elite Dangerous thing?" It's got to be the players in our community. I mean, you're amazing. A little bit scary at times and a little bit bonkers, but you're absolutely amazing and I wouldn't change a thing for the world. Definitely the community is my favourite thing. So a few other shout outs. First of all, Commander Schlack for trying his level best to completely dominate the questions tonight. We did see your forum thread asking for one of these live streams.
Yeah.
That was after it was on the plan, so
yep.
So it wasn't just for you, although we applaud your coordination efforts of rounding up everybody's questions and posting them for us.
Yeah, well, we started the Q&A things before the Christmas break.
Yes.
And then it got in the way.
Absolutely.
And we finally got around back to doing it, but there'll be lots more of these.
Absolutely. I'm going
to
give a shout out to some of the fuel rats as well, because I'm going to name a few names. Commander Zabzolver, Termite Altair, Refresh and Caprica 6 and about half a dozen others. I'm sorry, I really didn't write down your names. The few outs have been helping Howard and me with some instancing and connection debugging because they have the scale to be able to debug reproducible connection issues, and their help has been invaluable and is very, very gratefully received, so thank you to the few outs. Commander Ben Ryder said, I just made triple elite. Are you silly? I mean, congratulations,
wow.
Commander to Ben Ryder. Triple elite is no mean achievement.
Unbelievable, and it is actually an achievement on Xbox Live as well if you're doing it on Xbox One.
Absolutely.
You're doing it on PC anyway.
No.
But I'm nearly elite in one of them.
Yeah, well, elite in exploration, that's an amazing task, even before the passenger changes in 2.2 for passenger missions.
It's the last push between Pioneer and Elite is
big.
A bit all chunky. 60.
I forget how many millions of credits of exploration.
80 data. Million, I think, just between Pioneer and Elite.
Yeah.
So, and then before that, it's 100. I mean, let's look at my stats.
Absolutely.
Well, let's just show off. Round of applause, everyone! I'm doing it. It was like a little sort of soft finish.
Little round
of applause for Dav, everybody, for getting through all of those questions. Absolutely amazing. Show some respect in the chat for Dav. Tell him how much you like him and how much you want to see him again doing more Q&As in the future.
Commander Nexmix asks,
because he's very, very good. Very impressive.
Some months ago, I experienced lots of disconnects during system jumps in open play while in empty space away from the bubble. That was probably a server crash behind the scenes. All right, should be fixed now.
Combat, don't look at my combat. It's embarrassing.
Absolutely.
Look at that, 84 million profit from exploration so
indeed.
Far.
So for those people in the audience who are asking questions over and over again, and we hear that you have questions, I'm afraid that they're just not for me to answer. I couldn't even begin to talk about graphics drivers, for example. That's so far out of my comfort zone and understanding, I wouldn't do anything useful by doing that. So you're not being ignored, it's just not super relevant. I'm going to try my best to go to LaveCon. I buy my ticket every year, it's awesome. Brian Greenberg asks, can we get the group and friends list sorted alphabetically? I ask about that once every 2 months or so.
And the answer is always...
It's not my area, so okay. But the people whose area it is, I do keep nagging them.
Okay.
But I'm not master of other people's time.
Sure.
So should we give them one last picture of a guinea pig?
Yeah, so whilst we close on it?
Yeah, let's
briefly. We can sort of leave it on there as the thanks for
absolutely.
Watching the screen, perhaps. Unless this is another one you want to put up. It's just
no, I'm pretty much done. People say, what can we do to make the servers less crashy? If we wrote it in Erlang, we'd have an entirely different set of problems, I assure you, right, Commander Dobby Stevenson.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very, very much. Audio problems, apparently. It's a shame. It might be scratching you. Where's your microphone gone? Have you dropped it?
I dropped my microphone.
That's what's... No, that's mine. Where's yours? It's on the left-hand side. Where did it disappear to? How did this even happen? Where's it?
You have to go down the lab coat.
Saucy ending. There you go. Is that better, everybody? Sorry about
I'm
that.
I'm really sorry for doing a mic drop at the end. I promise that wasn't intentional.
Sorry about that. I don't know
literally
how
a mic drop. That's not a great way to end.
No, so let's pretend, let's wait, and then let's just wait till everybody is happy with the fixed microphone.
Yes, so apologies to everybody who had to listen to that.
Ah, don't worry about it.
It's a professional outfit.
Better.
Can you tell Chris Harris how to send you a PM on YouTube to get his prize from last week?
Email community@frontier.co.uk.
So send an email, don't send a private message on YouTube. Email community@frontier.co.uk with your YouTube handle in and say why you think you need a prize.
I'm not needed here anymore.
Only after you told me the answer.
Community@frontier.co.uk and then just put your details in there, the prize that you won, and we'll make sure it's sorted. It should have been sorted for you as soon as possible. Depends on which prize you won and when you won it. All right, everybody, say a huge thank you to Dav as well for all of his hard work on answering these questions, his hard work on the game, making this... being a large part of it, Dav, as everybody is, lots of large cogs.
There are a lot of
machine.
Large cogs. Really, I'm just one person from a big team of very talented developers.
Yeah. Fantastic. And as you can see, people really, really appreciated it. We honestly really appreciate you being here, sticking all the way. I mean, we had over 1,000 people here watching us today, watching you talk about server stuff. So how do you feel about that, Dav?
Stunned.
Yeah, isn't that nice? All right, well, thank you, guys. And we will see you on Thursday. We're doing a CQC night as well, so do come along when we invite a dev on then. But you can come back at some point and play some CQC with us.
I did that last time and it didn't end well.
It was fantastic.
It was fun, but didn't achieve anything.
Yeah, we do lots of prize giveaways, lots of paint job pack giveaways and things like that. So do come along to play some CQC against us on Thursday. We'll be playing on PC and on Xbox One again. So either way, come along. Go and have a good time with us. And then... And another, well, we'll be doing with lots of more information and cool stuff coming your way on these live streams on Tuesdays and Thursdays. youtube.com/frontierdevelopers/live right here. Keep coming back. Thank you again, Dav. Always a pleasure. Thank you, everybody at home.
It's a good night for me, and it's a good night from him.
There you go. See you next time.
Goodbye.